Hi, welcome back to Miller Guide. Today we're going to demystify exercise prescription as it relates to bone health. We're going to start with the recommendations put forth by the American College of Sports Medicine in regards to adults. The recommendations are that adults do some form of cardiovascular exercise 3 to 5 times a week for 30 to 60 minutes. Insofar as strength training, the recommendations are 2 to 3 times a week, covering a broad spectrum of muscle groups. So looking at a 45-minute routine with a number of different muscle groups in the body, because we know that unless you work on the muscles that are attached to those bones are not going to get stronger. Now, the intensity is what's new for most of the therapists that I've been teaching. The intensity needs to be in the range of 80% of one rep max. So one rep max means if you're going to take a healthy young individual and load them up and see what is the most weight that they can take one time, they would be strength training at 80% of that weight. Now, you and I know with the clients that we see that have, you know, multiple comorbidities or that are more frail or have not been exercising in some time, we don't push somebody to 80% one rep max, at least not at the beginning. And so with my clientele, it may take up to 6 months before they're working as hard as they need to stimulate bone, but exercise is a lifetime pursuit. And so giving them that time that they need to, you know, build up the mitochondrial elements of the cell, to build up the microcapillaries and, you know, have them eventually lift to the level that they need to lift to build bone is the wise thing to do. And so we'll talk more in terms of the prescription put forth in the Miller Guide. So in regards to pushing your clients, there was an interesting talk given at the World Physical Therapy Conference in Vancouver several years ago, and they were looking at bone health in the stroke population. And one of the resounding, you know, messages that they were giving was, we're not pushing our clients hard enough post-stroke recovery. So we look at the neurofacilitation, but we need to be more aggressive in terms of building muscle, which then stimulates the bone to build as well. Because in strokes, as in many comorbidities, there is a loss of bone when there's a loss of activity. There was a recent study in the Journal of Strength and Conditioning that looked at healthy individuals, and they took female population. One group was in the 25 age bracket, and the other was in the 65 age bracket, and they put them on very similar strength training programs, and they looked at their potential for improving strength. And there was virtually no difference whether the individuals were women were 25 or 65. So with your healthier clients, you can definitely push a 65-year-old as hard as you would push a 25-year-old, and giving them opportunities to build to that stamina, but they can build, and you should not use age as a discriminating factor. So what are some of the exercise options for individuals with low bone density, osteoporosis, or osteopenia? Well, at Chapters, if you go and you scour the shelves at Chapters, there are a lot of exercise books in relation to bone health, but most of these books were written by nutritionists or doctors. And the chapter that's included on exercises was really put in there as an afterthought. And I have a little story to share, but there was a book signing, and I won't declare which book it was, but it had to do with bone health. And because one of my clients happened to know the author, the MD who had signed off on this book, he said, oh, you really should go and meet her, very neat individual. So when I did go and meet her at the book signing, I brought up my concerns in regards to the exercise chapter on the book, in the book, because one of the exercises had individuals actually standing on exercise balls without any guidance whatsoever, but just standing on exercise balls. And I said, you know, that's a rather risky thing to do, you know, blatantly putting that, you know, anybody, whether they're at high factor risk or not, you know, to have them standing on balls. And her response to me was, oh, I actually never looked at the chapter on exercise. And so oftentimes these books are written to sell. And again, you know, they're wanting to round out the book, so they'll throw in something on exercise, but there isn't an exercise expert that's involved in creating that book. And that's where Miller Guide differs. And so at Mueller Guide, I like to think that although, you know, we're never an expert and I'm learning every day and I learn from my clients every day, that my knowledge of physical therapy and my knowledge as a certified strength and conditioning specialist has allowed me to put together what I think is a very safe exercise program. It is not a one-size-fits-all. It's a four-tiered exercise program. So we start at a beginner level. Individuals can move up to active, to more athletic, and into an elite level program. And throughout the program, we don't focus just on strength or just on balance or just on cardio, but all the facets of fitness are addressed. So we have a section addressing specifically strength exercises, balance exercises, flexibility exercises that, although we know flexibility is not an imperative component in terms of bone health itself, it's imperative that someone be flexible enough to be able to move with good body mechanics. And so how to stretch safely is very important because how we move throughout the day and activities of daily living has a very strong focus in the program as well. But how we move and how we teach somebody to move is incredibly important in the exercise program so that there is the carryover to keep their spine safe. When it comes to exercise, a lot of you, or I hope many of you, are now familiar with Dr. Zanacki's study that was produced in 1984 looking at the contraindication of flexion exercises in a program for individuals with osteoporosis. And that recommendation, you know, we saw, you know, through her studies that, you know, doing flexion exercises led to significant increase in fracture rates. And doing extension exercises where you're stimulating the back extensor muscles led to a significant reduction in fracture rates. But it wasn't until recently that we really understood more why that occurred. It was very exciting for me to be able to speak to one of the Swiss researchers at the October 2010 American Society of Bone Mineral Research conference that was held in Toronto, and he had looked at the morphology of the lumbar spine, specifically one lumbar vertebrae. And he found that the trabeculae was less dense in the anterior part of the vertebral body. So that, you know, made a lot more sense in terms of why when individuals do repeated flexion exercises, why does the anterior vertebral body give way and compress when someone already has weakened bone? So that was very interesting. The blog that we wrote in regards to that interview that I had with that individual and his research findings can be found at the link below. I strongly encourage you to read the paper written by Charles Turner, and the link is below as well, where he looked at bone strength. And in his paper, he describes bone strength as it relates to mechanical loading or the accretion of or strengthening of bone through mechanical loading. Because we know that with exercise, we can get, you know, a small increase in bone mineral density, especially in the postmenopausal years, unlike a drug that can have significant increase in bone mineral density. But it's the type of bone and the quality of the bone that I'm most concerned about and my clients are concerned about. So with mechanical loading, he found that even just a 5 to 8% bone mineral density change led to a 60% increase in bone strength, and it led to a 100% decrease in fracture rates. So that to me was very significant. So even small gains in bone mineral density, we know through mechanical loading, through exercise, can lead to significant improvement in bone strength. And so the link to that article is below as well. One of my motivations when creating Mueller Guide was that if you go to any of the osteoporosis websites, or you ask anybody who's been recently diagnosed with osteoporosis what the recommendations in regards to exercise they've been given is, and they all say, well, you know, I've read and my doctor's told me I really need to do strength training and weight bearing. But that's the entire guidance that they get. And, you know, God knows I've seen so many unsafe strength training exercises, and not all weight bearing exercises are created equal. And so Mueller Guide provides individuals with a very safe strength training programs. And in regards to weight bearing, this is where cardiovascular exercises fall into place, and we provide guidance in terms of high recommendations, moderate recommendations, and low-level recommendations in terms of bone building. Many of my clients, when they call me up, have already, you know, done a lot of search on osteoporosis, and they have great questions when it comes to exercise. They also have really good questions in regards to nutrition and drugs. And so it's, although as exercise specialists, we are not nutritionists and we are not pharmacists, but we should have some basic understanding of the drug therapies that are used with low bone density and osteoporosis, and we should have some basic understanding of the recommendations for calcium, for vitamin D, because our clients will ask your advice and you do need to have an opinion. And so that's what I'm going to give you, a little overview on nutrition and pharmacotherapy tomorrow. Look forward to seeing you then.